So, first of all, I think we're going to start with a poll. If we can get the poll up. So first of all, if you could answer this question, have you changed your crop protection programme in the last year to adopt new chemistry that's been available? And so have a look at that. And so our first speaker today is Dr. Neil Havis.
Thanks, Alistair. So that's really interesting to see. Majority of you have changed and looked at new chemistry in the last year. So I'll touch on new chemistry at the end of my talk. I'm going to talk about fungicide performance, and we'll mention products which are close to market as part of that. Let's see if I can share my screen. Right, you need to stop sharing, Alistair, I think.
That should be you, Neil.
Okay. Does that come up? Can you see that?
Perfect.
Okay. Right. So as Alistair says, thanks for the introduction. I'm going to give a kind of barley disease update, say a bit more about what we've seen at our trial sites this year and the kind of growing conditions we've had in the last year or so. Shit. Why is it not going down to the next slide? Okay, so those of you who came to the online meeting last year, remember I said a 2020, a season like no other. It's getting a bit of a familiar story, this. So 2021's turned into a very strange year as well, not just apart from the usual virus situations that we've experienced. So in terms of growing conditions, it's been a very unusual year. This is a graph you can see. This is the Met Office graphs. And you can see on the left, so this is the temperature and it's compared against the 30-year average. And you can see by that blues, we had a particularly colder than normal winter. In terms of rainfall, apart from the northwest, which was drier than normal, most countries had average or above average rainfall. So generally a cold, relatively wet winter for crops to establish and maintain through the growing season. But then we went from winter and we went into April. And of course, you can see on the graph on the left, if you look at the temperatures, these are the actual temperatures. There's lots of blues in there. If you compare that with the 30-year average on the right, you can see we are well below average in terms of temperature. So having had a cold, wet winter, we then had a very cold April. And when we add in the rainfall figures, of course, you can see on the left, this is the actual values, and we're pretty much looking at practically no rainfall at all. Compare that with a 30-year average, and we're well, well below average. So you can see after that cold, wet winter, we had I was going to say unusually dry April, but if you remember back to last year, we had another dry April as well. So that's two dry Aprils in a row. Last year, it continued into a warm, dry May, but not the situation we've seen this year. On the left-hand side, you can see the actual rainfall values. So you can see there's some browns in there, and some blues as well. So we started to see a bit more rain in terms of May. But if you compare that with a 30-year average, look at the dark blues. That's 200% of the normal May rainfall for the 30-year average. So very cold, dry April, and another cold, wet May to follow straight on after it. Okay, so adding in the temperatures, there's your temperatures, that's the mean temperatures in May. So there's a few more reds and pinks, so that's great, we're up 8-10 degrees. But again, compare that with a 30-year average, and you can see here we're blue, we're well below the average temperatures. So all in all, the whole growing season, we've been below averages in temperatures. There's been big fluctuations in rainfall, rain available to the crop for growth. But remember, temperature is one of the major drivers of plant growth and development, and that's affected the plant growth. And I'll say a bit more about what we've seen at the different sites as we go on. And that's just a picture taken from the 5th of May this year. That's the winter barley at Drumalbin, and it's covered in frost. So getting frost like that is not unknown in May, but it's still disappointing to see it. Okay, so briefly, we'll talk about major challenges still facing barley crops. I'll touch on the growing conditions, a bit about the disease threats, and what are the control options that we have. Okay, so as Alistair says, one of our major barley sites is at Drumalbin Farm in Lanarkshire. So here we have winter barley and spring barley. In terms of the winter barley, it went in September. Good conditions, it established well. We put in LG Mountain for fungicide trials. We put in a range of varieties for a variety screen, and you'll hear a bit more about varieties from Steve shortly. There's a fungicide performance trial there looking at the efficacy of the major agrochemicals against Rhynchosporium in winter barley, and we have a range of IPM trials. I'll touch on one of my IPM trials, and Henry will mention some of the trials he has as we go on through the talks. So this is what we saw. Good establishment, as I said. We had that cold winter, but the 13th of February, you can see the plots well established, looking green. But then we had that very cold condition, so the crop practically stood still. There was very little development in terms of crop growth. We're usually expecting to see growth stage 30, 31 in winter barley the first 2 weeks in April, and we only really reached it at the start of May. It's okay. So we're behind. Even on the 17th of May, a bit more warmer temperatures, the crop started to come, but it was still well behind. We have other barley trials at SRUC Rockhall Farm, and they were well ahead of the Drumalbin site. So at that point, we thought it was maybe 3 weeks difference between them. The 17th of May, they were catching up. Once the high temperatures came in, the crop caught up. So it's practically maybe a week behind now. There's a week's difference. So remember, cereal crops are capable of fast and rapid growth and development, and that's what we saw this year. So even though the cold weather checked a lot of crops, once the warmer temperatures came in, they caught up fairly quickly. In terms of spring laureate, spring barley, it was sown in 24th of March. We used laureate for spring barley fungicide work. There are a number of ramularia trials there from commercial sponsors. There's also a fungicide performance trial on ramularia at the Drumalbin site. And we have one of the AHDB recommended list trials in spring barley there. So they went in March, nice dry seedbed, but again, those cold conditions meant the crop was late in developing, but it is catching up. And as we've seen, it's got two awns peeping and further, even within the last 3 or 4 weeks. In terms of disease pressure across the sites, these are some photographs taken this year. What we have seen is a lot of disease at the barley trials at Bockhall Farm. Seen some Rhynchosporium at Drumalbin, but a lot of mildew at Bockhall. What we've also seen particularly strongly is a lot of yellow rust at the Bockhall site. Now, this barley trials are co-located with wheat, which had a lot of yellow rust as well. So we don't know whether this is just a straight passover from the wheat to the barley. Samples have been sent off to NIAB for investigation, but an awful lot of yellow rust in 2021. We've also seen the usual threat to barley yields in terms of Rhynchosporium, and disease levels are high. And in some of the spring barley, the crops, this is in the Propino at the Drumalbin site, there's net blotch present as well. And that's unusual. We don't usually see much net blotch this far north, but we're seeing it this year. So that's been helped by the warmer temperatures in May and June, and there's a question mark about whether that's come in the seed as well. Okay, so one of the trials we'll be looking at last year and we're repeating this year, we've been trying to build an IPM program. So that's looking at an elicitor as a seed treatment and then looking at different T-naught options. So the idea of elicitors is you use them at T-naught to replace that TNOT fungicide, and then you can reduce your fungicide inputs later on in the program. This is one of the trials that we did. This is untreated winter barley seed last year. So the blue lines are percentage rhynchosporium late in the season, and you can see the disease levels are not high. But you can see the green line, this is the yield that we saw in the trial. So you can see differences between the treatments. So having Kayak, a commercial fungicide, at the T-knot spray timing give you a slight yield increase over the untreated. Some of the other T-knot treatments didn't perform particularly well. Citco SA, which is a silicon-based product that actually gave the biggest yield increase, is the T-knot spray followed by reduced rate fungicide. So this was in the untreated seed. We did the same. Half of the trial was an untreated seed. Half had a laminarin seed treatment. And you can see there's bigger differences here in terms of what we see from the yield. So compared to the laminarin as a seed treatment, the no fungicide, all of these TNOT options gave an increase in yield. And again, good performance by the Citco SA, good performance from the Kayak, but also other products such as Zinergy gave a yield increase. Again, 2020 was noticeable and notable for the low disease symptoms that we saw. So these trials are all being repeated this year. We're seeing a lot more Rhynchosporium, so and taking them through to yield. So it'll be interesting to see what we see in a more normal disease pressure yield. Okay, so lastly, I just wanted to touch on the fungicide performance trials. So you'll all be aware that HDB fund these range of trials, looking at the control of Rhynchosporium, net blotch and ramularia on different varieties. And they looked at different diseases. So unfortunately, SRUC lost their spring barley program last year, so there was no ramularia fungicide performance trial to report on. And the work from the trial in Carlow in Ireland, run by Chuggis, gave no significant disease. So I'll give you some brief summary on what was found last year. Looked at the usual chemical input, so proline being the basis of many fungicide programs, Imtrex as an SDHI, obviously the new product, Revistar XE, that combination of the methotrifluconazole, Revisol, and the SDHI fluxoperoxad. We've got the Inatrec and prothioconazole in there, so it's been in trial. I won't show you the curves, but I'll give you a summary for what you might expect from its activity. There's the Myresa, so that's the straight Revisol, the Siltra X Pro, Kayak, and they also left Bravo in the trials just for comparative purposes. And obviously Bravo being the big change from last year to this year. So Rhynchosporium eradicate, Revistar, as you can see, very good control in eradicate situation, not far off Imtrex, not slightly ahead of proline probably. In terms of mixed, so that's mixed protectant and eradicant activity, you can see here a clear difference in the efficacy of Revistar compared to Imtrex and proline. So Imtrex is still doing well, proline a bit further behind in these situations in this mixed trial. In a protectant situation, which ideally we would be wanting to using the fungicides, Siltra X Pro still doing well against Rhynchosporium. You can see the proline component is doing a reasonable job, but the addition obviously of the bixafen is helping, and there's the SDHI on its own. So in terms of Rhynchosporium protection, we've still got good options available. Net blotch. Here's the net blotch in an eradicant situation, and you can see not so steep these curves. So if net blotch is in and it is established, the fungicides are struggling to give you decent control. So here you're talking about 50% control from a full recommended dose. And you can see it's not a strength. Many pathogens, once they're established, are very difficult to control. Net blotch is no exception. That's the eradicant situation. If you looked at it in a protectant situation, you would see you've got more options. So the proline and the Imtrex do far better. Look at that, highly significant control even from half a dose. So big argument if net blotch is a worry or using a protectant spray. And you can see disappointing results from the Kayak and so on. So you saw in the previous slides, there was no real significant ramularia levels in the Chagas trial last year. This is the data from 2019. We know Revistar, one of the strengths it has is controlling ramularia. And this year, we actually saw some control from Proline. So a half dose of Proline's given you around about 50% control. Whether that continues is a big question mark. What we don't have in here, obviously, for comparison is chlorothalonil. We know chlorothalonil is by far the most effective fungicide against ramularia. The other multi-site, Fulpit, has been looked at in trials. I've seen or spoken to pathologists in Ireland this year, and they've seen pretty good control of Brincosporium and ramularia from the Fulpit. And there's other research from across Europe which indicates that two applications of Fulpit can give good control of ramularia. It's just coming into our trials now, so we'll be able to report on that more properly and in more detail in future events. But it's something to think about, and it's one of the burning topics I know many growers are interested in, is what can they expect from the Fulpit. So it'd be good if it gave good control, but again, we wait and see what we get from the trials. Okay, so in summary, there's that Brincosporium. So you have the SDHI Intrex option, slightly ahead of the Proline. There's a Revistar. Now, you didn't see it in the curves, but the Inatrec and Prothioconazole, in terms of activity, is close to the Revistar. In terms of net blotch, it's also close to the Revistar XE and the Proline and Imtrex for eradicant. And in a protected situation, they're all grouped together as well. In terms of ramularia, the data that we do have for Revistar and Inatrec and Prothioconazole indicate they are quite close together. They're certainly better than the Proline option. So wait to see if the registration for Inatrec and Barley goes through. But again, at least it's going to give us more of an option going forward. Okay, so thanks very much for your attention, and I'll pass you on to Steve Hoad to talk about varieties.
Well, thanks for that, Neil. Now we've got...
Did Henry have his hand up there, Alistair? Or is that just... Was that gone away? Sorry.
No, it's okay. Thanks very much for that, Neil. If anybody's got any questions for Neil, just pop them in the Q&A we'll get to them at the end. Next is Steve Hoad, and he's going to be running through some spring and winter barley varieties. And I think we're starting off with a video. So if we could have run the video on, that'd be great.
Hello. Today we're at one of SRUC's spring barley sites. This particular one is in East Lothian. So here we've got co-located national list and recommended list variety trials. Now, in terms of the spring barley trials, we carry these out across several different locations in Scotland. So this enables us to build up quite a large database of yield and quality features so that we can look at stability over years and between sites of our favoured varieties. What you'll see behind me are the replicated recommended list and the national list trials, both treated and untreated. I'm standing next to the market leader, Laureate, and this is actually a bank of what we call untreated plots. So untreated in the sense of not using fungicide. What you'll see from these plots here as they approach Orns emerging, Orns peeping, is that the crop's quite short, and that's true across the whole trial. And I think that reflects some of the very cold conditions we've had earlier in the spring, which had an impact on the speed of development and the development of plant height. So what I'm going to do today is to go through the top picks from the Scottish list And just to flag up some of the changes in the market potential of the newer varieties. So as I say, I'm standing by Lorette here. Lorette certainly dominated the intake from the crop last harvest. In terms of the Scottish intake, it was close to 70% of the market share. And in England, it was about 40% of the intake. So you can see that Lorette is really developing that dual purpose malt distilling and brewing in terms of its intake. So when we think of the key varieties in Scotland, we tend to have one or two varieties that get to that dominant position. And supporting Lorette at the moment, we have KWS Sassy, which had about 14% of the intake from last harvest, and also LG Diablo. So that had just under 10% of the intake. So those three would be the main varieties for malt distilling. And for the grain distilling sector in Scotland, we're still referring to Fairing as the key variety. At the moment, although Fairing is regarded now as being outclassed for yield, there isn't a variety that quite meets the spec in terms of achieving the grain nitrogen as Fairing does. So on those leaders then, in terms of Lorette, it still retains a pretty good position in terms of its untreated yield. So that's holding up quite well. Compared to Diablo, its yield is now a few points behind in terms of the highest yielding varieties, but certainly it has consistency across sites and over years. And as I say, its untreated yield is pretty good. One weakness in Lorette that we sometimes pick up is the lower specific weight. So that's just something to bear in mind. In some years, it might throw up the lower specific weight values. But otherwise, agronomically, it remains pretty strong. So as I said, LG Diablo has got that yield advantage over Lorette. And like Lorette, it actually suits both the malt distilling and the brewing sectors. So it's possible that over the next year or two that we could see Diablo develop similar inroads into the main malting sectors in the way that Lorette has done in recent years. The other variety that's of much interest in Scotland is KWS Sassy. So like Lorette, it's been very consistent in terms of its yield performance across yields, and it has a similar maturity at that plus one on the AHDB scale. So those three varieties together, I would say that Lorette and the Sassy are the slightly earlier maturing varieties, Diablo just being a little bit later. Do look out for higher lodging or brackling risks with Sassy on the more vulnerable sites. So we do pick up differences between those three varieties. So Lorette and LG Diablo faring better in all-round straw stiffness and brackling resistance. So do just have that as a note of caution with Sassy on the more exposed, vulnerable sites. I mentioned Fairing, so this is the variety that's still recommended by the Malting Barley Committee for the grain distilling sector. So although it is well down on yield compared to the top varieties now, it still actually has some agronomic features that might make it of value in feed areas, for example, such as its early maturity and general all-round good agronomics. So Fairing, I think, is still has a place for the next couple of years or so. I'd like to now think of a couple of new varieties that have real potential for the malt distilling sector in Scotland. So first of all, we have SY Tungsten that has provisional 2 approval from the MBC for both malt distilling and brewing. And we also got Firefox, which has provisional 2 approval for distilling. Now, both these varieties seem to be hitting the yields of the Diablo level. So that's a real positive going forward. Both varieties have very similar maturity to Laureate. So they've got that Diablo yield, but they don't have that slightly later maturity. Both of them, I would say, Firefox and SY Tungsten, perhaps need just a little bit more looking after in terms of the untreated yield. So they're just a few points down compared to Laureate and Diablo in terms of the untreated yield. But certainly look out for those two varieties for positioning as alternatives to Laureate for spring 2022. On the Scottish list, we also include several brewing varieties. Now, although that sector isn't so large in Scotland compared to down south, we include these varieties for their versatility on farm. So they have use either for brewing or for feed. And the established variety has been RGT Planet. So a very, very widely grown variety now across the UK and across Europe. And it's actually shown to have considerable stability, strong yield performance across sites and many seasons. So for an early maturing, relatively stable yielding general purpose variety for brewing and for feed, then RGT Planet certainly sets the standard. It's a variety that has a big brewing intake down south for the English market. Following RGT Planet in that brewing sector, we have SY Splendor that's on its second year on the recommended list now. And SY Splendor has yields at that Diablo level of 103. So for a high yielding variety, and if there is some brewing opportunity, then SY Splendor would seem to be a good choice. That variety, like Tungsten and Firefox, has a provisional 2 approval from the Malting Barley Committee. A year behind SY Splendor, we have Skyway. Again, this is another brewing variety. Again, it could be like Planet and like Splendor, it could be developing a niche interest in Scotland, but it does look promising in terms of its high yield potential, and certainly feed areas could benefit from any of these brewing varieties. I just finished with one out and out feed variety, and that's Prospect. So relatively high yielding, so 102, so just behind the highest yielding malting varieties. So Prospect looks very interesting. It's got some good characteristics for feed, having relatively good specific weights. It's got excellent Bracklin resistance with the highest 9 rating. So I think as an out-and-out feed variety, that would be our top choice, along with the supporting malt distilling or the brewing varieties.
And thanks for that, Steve. Now, I think Steve has also got a presentation to continue after the video. I'll hand over to Steve just now.
Okay, thanks very much, Alistair. We've just got on the screen the summary of the spring barley varieties, so we can make this summary also available to attendees on request. So it's just indicating here the market leaders, and then those few varieties on the way up, Tungsten Firefox, Splendor and Skyway, and then Planets as a good all-rounder and Prospects as our top feed variety. So what I'll do is I'll just pick up my screen share now, and hopefully this comes up. Yes, so I hope everyone can see that okay. So what we've done here is that Neil has captured some images, some recent images of several of the winter barley varieties from the site at Drumalbin. And we'll just go through these just as examples of the key sectors, the key varieties that we are recommended for this autumn. So if you think of the real kind of top choices in the two row feed and the six row hybrids, well, I've just highlighted them here. So each of these six, I'll just go through some images and some data with you in a moment. So these really kind of represent the highest yielding and the best sort of all-round quality that's available at the moment. And at the end, I'll just flag up some of the newer varieties that are going to be offering us, I think, great choices over the next couple of years. So these are, I suppose we could think of these as being the standards, and then we'll end up with some of the up-and-coming varieties that are driving yield and some of the quality aspects further forward. So starting with LG Mountain here, this is really setting a new standard in the two row feed varieties with its 105 for yield. So that's really very close to the hybrids, the six row hybrids, and certainly the older hybrids. And you can actually see from the image on the left that the Mountain does have these rather long ears, high grain number per ear, that's contributing to that extra yield. In the slides, I'm also showing where Neil has captured a part of a treated and an untreated plots. So you can see diseases coming in, that there'll be some ringosporium and some mildew, but these diseases can increase quickly over a short period of time. So do bear this in mind, particularly for varieties like Mountain that have got what we call towards poor disease resistance for mildew and ringosporium, for example. So that can increase rapidly over a short period of time. And certainly in the untreated here, you can see lesions appearing quite clearly. This is just a snapshot of part of the Scottish recommended list. And I'll just do this for each variety so that afterwards you can go back and look at the full data set. But you can quite clearly see here the position of Mountain at top yielder among the two rows. And it's relatively good characteristics in terms of grain quality, reasonable straw strength, early maturity, and those disease resistances being towards poor. Moving on to Orwell now. We've included this one as, I suppose, it represents that sort of KWS series. So whereas the older varieties like Tower, Cresswell, and Glacier have come off the list or have become outclassed, Orwell still retains a place. So not as high yielding as LG Mountain, so it's about 101 on average, but I think it still has a place within the top choices for the two rows. So do bear this this variety in mind. Note that it does have quite a severe weakness to mildew. So that will become an issue if treatment is poor in those more vulnerable sites for mildew. Just to show you the position there of Orwell on the list of two rows. So you can see its relative strengths there in terms of having a stiff straw, pretty low in terms of screenings, but you can see that that weakness for mildew, and it's slightly better than mounting for Rhynchosporium. We've included Valerie here because this, like mountain, which is a significant development in terms of yield, Valerie's is another significant development in terms of agronomic features. So it's a kind of more rounded agronomic package here. So overall, it's the best for the combination of grain quality and other agronomic features among all of the varieties. So not quite as high yielding, but in terms of that bringing together grain quality and some of the best disease resistances, then Valerie's certainly going in the right direction. You can certainly see that its ears don't have the same number of grains as something like LG Mountains. So you can see that it's in that aspect alone, it does make that lower yield potential more evident. But in other agronomic features, it's very strong. So here's the position on the list. So you can see in the middle section there, it's very low in terms of screenings, got fantastic specific weight, and has stiff straw. It's also the two row with the best untreated yield. Hawking, KWS Hawking is a newer KWS variety. It's in second year on the list now. There is another one I mentioned at the end, but it's part of this series where there's this gradual yield improvement a year on year within this particular program. So again, it's another option, and it has sort of reasonable, sort of intermediate Rhynchosporium and net blotch resistance. As well as having that intermediate yield value, so you can see the position of it here. Okay, so again, it's a relatively stiff straw like Orwell and Valerie, and I think it's a useful part of the two row portfolio. So just finishing now with a couple of hybrids. So we've got Bazooka. So this is kind of the older standard now, and it has, in fact, the same yield as LG Mountains. So the best of the two rows is now the same as the sort of the, perhaps the weaker of the six row hybrids. But you can certainly see that when these crops develop large canopies and very bold ears, that's when we do see that increased weakness in straw stiffness. So do try to go for the varieties or the newer ones that have got slightly stiffer straw if you're concerned about weakness in straw strength. So within the hybrids, there's quite a choice. So you can see here we've got new high yield in Kingston and Thunderbolt. But what I'll do is I'll show you next the established King's Barn as an example of one of the very high yielding varieties on the list. And certainly King's Barn, again, it's another useful step forward in terms of yield, but also it's a variety that's has got the best resistance or joint resistance for mildew, so seven for mildew, and some all-round sort of good grain quality features. So you can see its position on the list here, and so it's a good specific weight, relatively low screenings, and as I say, a good score for mildew. But do look out for in these very high yielding six row hybrids that the sevens for straw stiffness can be a little weak in the bumper crops. So that was the list that we've just gone through, sort of representing our top choices and just varieties to make you aware of, to look out for. I'm going to flag up the new ones, KWS TARDIS, Bolton and Bordeaux. These are all really taking yield forward. So they're all higher yielding than the established Orwell and Hawking. So they're very close to LG Mountain in terms of yield. So I think that's quite an exciting development there going forward, particularly with some improvement in disease resistance, good specific weight and stiff straw. And the two new hybrid six rows I've just mentioned, these look quite exciting as well in terms of their yield, generally good grain quality and good disease resistance. So Kingston and Thunderbolt. So it's quite an exciting list, plenty of choice. So do take advantage of this when you make your selections for this autumn. Okay, thanks very much.
Well, thanks for that, Steve. There's a lot of great information there. And if you have any questions for Steve, just put them in the Q&A or the chat function at the bottom of the screen. So moving along, we're now going to hear from Dr. Lorna Cole, and she's going to tell us about the role of beneficial insects in integrated pest management. So I'll hand you over to Lorna.
Thank you, Alistair. I will just share my screen, so hopefully you should now have access to my PowerPoint. And we are going to start by doing something a little bit different, and we're going to have a little quiz. So I'm going to show you a series of insects, and I want you to identify if the insect is a pest or a beneficial. To do this, if you could type in the chat pest or P for pest or B or beneficial. If you know exactly what the insect is, please do type that in as well. So the reason we're doing this is it's important that we recognise who are the good guys and who are the bad guys in farming. So this is our first insect. So if you think it is a pest, type P in the chat. If you think it's a beneficial, type B. And anyone who wants to take a punt at what it is, please do feel free. So John thinks it's a beneficial. Oh, Jackie's on the ball. She's saying beneficial and lacewing. Yep, indeed, this is actually a lacewing larvae. And these creatures, they like to feed on aphids, so definitely a beneficial. It's got these kind of pincer-like mandibles. I think most gruesome or startling about lacewing larvae is they have this tendency to collect the carcasses of their victim. So they will catch aphids, they will suck out the juice, if you like, and they'll place the carcasses on their body and they'll move around with this bunch of dead aphids on top of them. The reason we think they do that is so they can enter into aphid colonies and not be deterred by ants. Quite often ants will protect aphids and get the honeydew from them. So our next insect, what do you reckon? Is this a pest or a beneficial? Lily's saying pest, I think. Any advance in pest? Most people are thinking pest, and you're absolutely right. This is a cereal leaf beetle. Actually, it's quite a pretty looking beetle, but it is economically damaging to a range of cereal crops. It creates these kind of strip-like lesions in the leaf, and on the right we have its larvae, which looks very much like an absolutely tiny slug. And more importantly, from the larvae's point of view, it looks like a bird dropping. So that provides it with some protection. So our next guy, he's actually quite big. Henry gave me into trouble for not having a scale. So I'll tell you, he's about a centimetre to a centimetre and a half long. Oh, Jackie's on the ball. She's got a ground beetle. Anyone else thinking? So Jackie is right. It is indeed a ground beetle. And this is the ground beetle Cichrus caraboides, also known as the snail hunter. You'll notice it's kind of got a long pointed head and quite a narrow thorax. And that's so it can delve into snail shells and eat snails, so definitely a beneficial. How about this guy? I think he's quite tricky. And he looks very like a pest, but he is actually a beneficial. This is the larvae of a hoverfly, and a lot of the hoverflies are predatory, particularly in aphids. So this little guy will like to munch through colonies of aphids. Also pollinator, they pollinate as they are when they are adults, apologies. So our next person, now here you can see how mistakes can happen. This looks very similar to this. Both are fly larvae. Fly larvae tend to be a bit awkward to identify. They tend to be creamy with no legs, no real distinguishing features. And this one is indeed, as you have very well pointed out, this is a fruit fly larvae, wheat bull fly larvae. And this is a common pest in cereals. It causes dead heart. So definitely a pest. And finally, this group of insects here. So most people are agreeing that these are beneficial. So you might think by the look of them they're wasps, but they're actually the marmalade hoverfly, called a marmalade hoverfly because they're this glorious deep orange colour, the exact colour of marmalade. Now, this could be your super pollinator. As an adult, they're busy visiting flowers. They particularly like open flowers, so flowers such as oilseed rape, fruit trees. They'll pollinate a wide variety of open flowers. And these little guys are extremely abundant in agricultural land, and their larvae are predatory in aphids. So this guy is a win-win all round. Aphid predator as a larvae and pollinator as an adult. So I'm sure everyone will have heard something recently about insects and their decline. So how are our beneficial insects faring? This is graph from the Environmental Change Network, where a standard approach to monitoring insects has been conducted over the last 20 years, 20 plus years actually. And what this data, you are seeing quite a lot of variability. Insects vary a lot from season to season, but on the whole, you're seeing a decline in these ground beetles. So ground beetles are very important predators. They prey on a range of agricultural pests. And we also have a similar decline when we look at our hoverflies. So again, and our bees, of course, but again, this is reason for concern. I think perhaps most worryingly is the fact that these populations are declining where we were monitoring them. Most insects we're not monitoring, and we have absolutely no idea what's happening with their populations. So we really can't tell what's happening to our other key groups. So I'm sure everyone will be aware of the wide range of things or jobs that these insects do. They cycle nutrients. We have our mites and our springtails in our soil. They pollinate crops, our bumblebees and our hoverflies. They create soil structure. They have bioturbulation. Our worms buddy through the soil and aerate it. We have our natural pest controls, our parasitoids and our ground beetles and our spiders. They are food for a range of other taxa. And I would also say they're very important in their own right. There, a lot of these creatures are very, very beautiful. So, I mean, for example, the peacock butterfly. So we know they do a lot of different jobs. So why do we need a diversity? First, different insects do different jobs. But if we focus simply on our natural enemies, and what you find is that different beneficials are active in different areas of the crop. So in our crop canopy, where we are getting grain aphids, you have ladybirds, parasitic wasps, sawfly larvae. These are all active in the canopy on the top of the crop. As you go through the crop, you have money spiders, which will build sheet-like webs. Now, these will trap prey items as they fall from the crop. So, and then finally, at ground level, we've got wolf spiders and ground beetles. And they'll feed on slugs, they'll feed on aphids. So, for example, if we have an aphid, a grain aphid that decides to fall to escape a ladybird, it could get trapped on a money spider web, or it could get munched on by ground beetles or wolf spiders on the ground. So all these insects, they act together and they complement each other in the job they do. And research have found where you've got a diversity of different insects, you get more effective pest control. So we really do want to try and maintain that diversity. So how do we do it? We need to really consider what these insects require. So what are the resource requirements and what habitats provide these resources? So if we start with winter, we need overwintering habitats, and species such as parasitic wasps and ground beetle, they like to overwinter in this kind of undisturbed tussocky grassy habitats where temperature fluctuations are minimized. Other species such as ladybirds and hoverflies, they are looking for nooks and crannies. So they quite often will hibernate in hedgerows or in woodland areas where there's little gaps between bark or, you know, under stones, these kind of habitats. So as our parasitic wasps and hoverflies emerge in March, April time, they're desperate to find food. And that's where early season pollen and nectar resources are quite important. So that could be willow or fruit trees, it could be dandelions. So these early season resources are very important. These species also need flowers throughout the season, and this is where flower-rich field margins can come into place. And because they've got relatively short mouth parts, they like open flowers. So flowers such as mayweed, common hogweed, angelica, these all provide forage. And the final thing is when there are not huge populations of aphids in crops, all these species need alternative sources of prey. Now that could be aphids in other areas. For example, quite often you get populations of aphids on plants such as mayweed or on thistles or in sycamore trees, but they may also eat each other. So some of the larger ground beetles will quite happily feed on money spiders as well. But overall, if we support a diversity of these habitats, then we also support a diversity of predators and wider beneficial insects, such as our bumblebees and butterflies. So I think it's time to pass on to Henry, I think. You're on mute, Alistair.
Just before we move on to Henry, I think we've got a poll to do. So if we can get the next poll up, that'd be great. So if you could answer the question, what is the most effective disease control measure in your opinion? So rotations, cultivations, variety, fungicides, or biologicals. So I'll now pass you on to Henry and see what he makes of the results there.
Thanks, Alistair. Can you see my screen at the moment?
Yep.
Brilliant. Thanks, Lorna. Okay, yeah, interesting. Thanks for completing that poll. Maybe by the end of the presentation, you may change your mind a little bit, perhaps not. We'll see. So today I'm going to talk to you about IPM practices on Scottish arable farms. Integrated pest management is a holistic approach to pest management, which maximises profitability and productivity whilst minimising the detrimental impacts of production on the environment. This is roughly how we'd structure an IPM programme, so the emphasis is on prevention and when interventions are used only when necessary. So preventative measures could be rotations, resistant varieties, and then we get into the identification of the pest. And when I say pest, I mean any harmful organisms, so that includes weeds and diseases as well. And keeping an eye on them, monitoring them to see if they get to levels that we need to intervene. And when we are intervening, we're only using chemistry as a last resort, really. Crucially, after we've been through this process, we have an evaluation period. And what's worked, what hasn't worked, what needs to be changed for the following season, for following crops. And that cycle is important to note, because that's how we can continually improve the way that we manage pests. To help with that that thought process, we've developed the Scottish IPM assessment plans, which are available on the Plant Health Centre website. It only takes about 15, 20 minutes to complete, those before your records. It's really to act as a tool to facilitate discussion with your agronomist. What are you doing now? What might you consider doing? What could potentially do in the future? And the implications of those changes in IPM practice. This also serves as an important data collection tool for us, so we can establish baselines to know what levels of IPM are currently being practiced. We've created a scoring system based on expert opinion, largely farmers and agronomists, which gives you an IPM score out of 100. But also we'll be able to see what practices are being adopted and why they're being adopted. This can hopefully identify some issues or topics and potential threats that require further attention from ourselves and others looking to do research and development and develop knowledge exchange strategies to remedy any issues. So please do take the time to go and complete one of these plans. We have an arable focus one and also a grass and focus one, both on the Plant Health Centre website at the moment. Today, I'm just going to briefly discuss some of the results from the arable crop surveys that we've conducted in the first few months of this year. So one of the first things we looked at was whether there was a relationship between IPM score, let's say the 0 to 100 scale, and the amount of area under arable. And we found that there's a strong positive correlation. So the larger the arable area, generally speaking, the higher the IPM score. Obviously, there's variation around that, but this correlation was highly significant. There could be various reasons for this. It could be having a larger farmed area, you've got more fields, more soil types, more ability to grow more crops and rotate them, for example. But also, if you're more dedicated, there's more a larger business in the arable part of your business, then there's perhaps more willingness to upskill when it comes to developing IPM practices and maybe buying in different types of advice as well. The next thing we looked at was whether there is a relationship between farmers' familiarity with IPM, which was self-assessed. They were asked to state whether what level of familiarity they had. And we found that there's a strong correlation between the familiarity and IPM score as well. So the more familiar a farmer is with IPM practices and IPM in general, typically speaking, they're having a higher IPM score as well. And this makes sense because if you want to adopt IPM practices to a high level, you need to become familiar with them first. You need to acquire the knowledge first. We looked at various other things related to the farm and the farm business that might affect IPM score, such as farmer age, but that had no bearing on, no effect on IPM score. What did was the number of farming related qualifications. So the more qualifications you have, generally speaking, you've got a higher IPM score. And so these qualifications include diplomas, degrees, but also a professional qualification such as basis. And on average, each qualification added gave an additional 5 IPM points. The reasons for this could be many, but generally speaking, it's assumed that the higher level of education, farming education you have, the more the ability to critically evaluate your IPM practices and improve upon those because you've already gained that knowledge and that critical thinking. So greater familiarity leads to an increase in IPM score, high number of qualifications around farming increase your IPM score, but also there are many other sources of information that can influence on-farm decision-making with regards to IPM. So we looked at these and we found that those individuals that are actively seeking IPM knowledge, going to the research organisations, interacting with their agronomists and attending crop walks and open days and really going to find out what's relevant, what's happening right now, what needs to be changed in this current season. Those individuals are scoring much higher for IPM practice than those that are more reliant on receiving the information passively, either through farming press or through other farmers acting as sort of middlemen. That's not to diminish the role of other farmers spreading the knowledge around IPM, what's worked and what hasn't. But if you're relying more heavily on your neighbours for IPM knowledge, then you're perhaps less likely to interact with those experts that have the current up-to-date advice to give. We recognise that various sources of information that affect IPM decisions being made on farm, and to that end, we've developed a new project kindly funded by the Plant Health Centre Scotland, where we're looking to identify trusted and accurate information sources around IPM. So we're looking at farmers, social networks, who they're speaking to, where they're getting advice from, and the same with agronomists as well. We want to know what sort of risks they deem associated with particular pests and diseases, and what informs decision making with regards to preventative measures, monitoring, detection, but also crucially those interventions and how you monitor those and change your response to pests throughout the season. So at the moment, over the next few weeks, our partner Ipsos Moro will be conducting phone call interviews. So if you do receive a call from them in the next few weeks, please do respond. It'll only be about 15 minutes of your time, and the information gathered will be really useful for working out the information flows around IPM, identifying key sort of strong points in social networks and potential weak points as well. And the outputs will be made publicly available and will be bespoke to Scottish stakeholders. So please, if you are an agronomist or farmer that does get a call from us in the next few weeks, please do take the time to respond. So we know that the source of information and level of familiarity and level of education affects IPM score, but we must be able to give farmers, through their agronomists, through researchers, the up-to-date and impartial IPM advice. And that's why we conduct many different types of IPM serial field trials at SRUC, where we're looking at different combinations of IPM techniques. So rather than just looking at varieties or just looking at fungicides, we're looking at interactions between varieties, fungicides, fungicide rates, products, timings, and elicitors, as Neil mentioned earlier, and how fertilizer programs can affect fungicide need and yield, sowing dates, sowing rates, and even tillage regime is something we started looking at recently. I'm just going to briefly summarize some of the findings from a few of those over the next few slides. This is a spring barley IPM trial, looking at the interaction between varieties and fungicide timings and frequency. This is kindly funded by the Magnus Lawson Trust and run by Ian Bingham. They're looking at two different varieties, one more susceptible to rhizosporin than the other. And they're testing out whether a T1 and a T2 are needed in every site in every year. What they found is that over multiple years, multiple sites, and all but one site, the T2 spray and booting was sufficient in protecting yield. Only in 2019 at our Lanarkshire site on the susceptible variety, the Concerto, were two sprays justified to protect yield. Looking at winter barley now, this trial looks at the interaction between sowing date and seeding rate, varieties and fungicides. So we have two different varieties, one more resistant to rhizosporium than the other, so Surge and Tower. And they're sown around about a month apart over 3 years at our Edinburgh site. And they were subject to four different fungicide programs ranging from untreated, so zero sprays, up to three sprays, that would be T0, T1, T2. What we found over those 3 years was that the greatest fungicide need was in the early sown and the susceptible varieties, which mirrors what we see in winter wheat as well. You see the yield of the varieties sown late and early, you'll see that Tower, the more susceptible, does need that fungicide to be able to protect yield, whereas the more susceptible, more resistant variety Surge is less affected by sowing date or the fungicides. So when you are sowing that Tower early, unless you protect it well, you're really going to suffer with your yields. And in those years, it was mostly ramularia and tan spot that affected those crops. Another winter barley trial, also funded by the Mains and Lawson Trust, is looking at the interaction between the tillage regime, variety, and fungicide. So what we've done here is kept the varieties and the fungicide programs the same as the other trial. And there's actually another couple of trials I've not mentioned today where we've kept the same variety and the same fungicide programs to allow for more easy comparison between trials. In this one, we're looking at the different tillage regimes and how that affects the varieties, disease, yield, and fungicide requirement. So we're looking at a direct drill where we have the straw removed from the soil surface, a direct drill with infected straw on the surface, and then a plough treatment as well. This is conducted at two sites, one at Doug Christie's farm in Leven and also at the Hutton site in Dundee. I was out there day before yesterday, and here's some initial results just from the Leven site, looking at the Rhynchosporium on leaf two, so flag minus one. As you can see there, the surge, the more resistant variety, is having quite low levels of Rhynchosporium across all of the tillage treatments, whereas the more susceptible, KWS tower, is having higher disease levels under the direct drill, both the direct drill treatments compared to the plough. So it'd be interesting to see how this relates to later disease and also yield as well, because in the direct drill plots, green leaf area in those lower leaves was maintained, whereas in the plough, it's pretty much finished. It was direct drill crops a little further behind. So to summarise, all farmers have and do adopt IPM to some extent, but there's a big range in that level of adoption. The higher IPM adopters are more familiar with IPM. They have a larger farmed area, particularly an arable area, and they have more farming qualifications. But crucially, they're more actively seeking IPM knowledge. It's our job to make sure that IPM advice is clear and consistent, evidence-based, and that based being on impartial trials that we conduct and others. And the final point is that IPM adoption is a responsibility of all stakeholders, as there could be various enablers and barriers that exist within the supply chain that are preventing or encouraging farmers to adopt IPM to higher levels, whether that be at the process, at the consumer, government level, and we need everyone pulling together to realise our goal of achieving a higher level of IPM than we're currently practising as a collective. Thank you.
So thanks for that, Henry. That's a lot of useful information there. And again, if you've got any questions for Henry, just put it in the Q&A or the chat function at the bottom of the screen there, and we'll get an answer for you. So moving on, we're now going to hear from Jillian Bell, and he's going to talk about the crop marketing outlook for 2021.
Yeah, thanks very much, Alistair. Good afternoon, everyone. I will just attempt to share my screen. Hopefully that'll work okay. So the focus is on barley today, and obviously malting is a big part of that, and of course feed. So I think this year there's probably more possible changes or potential range of prices that we could be seeing in the feed market that underpins barley and so wheat and other grains as well. So, you know, the big news globally is actually all about feed grains and about sort of tightening of sort of maize particularly. And so at the moment, that's been the biggest sort of factor pushing around malting barley prices, and the malting market itself has been a bit more subdued. It's obviously taken quite a hard sort of time over COVID and loss of sales of beer and spirits around the world. So the kind of front runner at the moment has been the feed grains, but I mean, that of course could change. I think when it comes to the malting barley itself, the premium, certainly it's actually more local factors. Obviously we've covered a fair few today in terms of, you know, how the crops, how do they perform, what are the yields like? And the quality is obviously sort of more local, probably could have an influence on the premium. So I'll be looking at that and some of the factors that, you know, obviously could play into that premium in the next few months. So, generally, it's very good news in terms of current prices. We've had this really big, sharp ramp up in wheat prices. They're up over £50 a ton since the autumn. Well, of course, rapeseed's up even more, over £100. Barley's been very similar, up nearly £60. And the late winter obviously helped bump up feed demand locally. And malting barley, well, it's our own barley is not really trading this time of year, but certainly if you look at export barley from the south coast of England, it's up significantly as well, not quite as much as the feed. So that's positive, but of course, well, what's driving it and what should we be looking out for to see where that all goes? The underlying thing when you look at the overall grain market is that we are expecting a big crop in 2021, plus 77 million tonnes. So that sounds kind of negative, but use is actually going to be up 54 million tonnes. And stocks to go up a little bit, 7 million tonnes, but actual stocks to use, because usage is higher, are set to fall. So it doesn't look too particularly dramatic at the moment, but the point is, even with a big crop, it's looking like it'll tighten a little bit this year. But of course, we've got to see how all these crops yield. So there's plenty of volatility there. But certainly a very interesting time with a lot of potential, well, up or down in that, coming from that world market. And this just shows what's pushed all this up at the moment is the US corn price, so Chicago maize. That's bumping up feed. It's obviously been a big boost to barley prices here as well. So any barley that goes out of the country has got a good demand against that higher price of maize. And slightly unprecedented things are happening in maize. The China's actually buying US maize, which it's never really done greatly before. So that may be a permanent thing, relatively permanent. There are droughts, issues, and probably a key is that there's a shortfall in soya at the same time that the maize is tight. And they're the two crops that battle it out for land because they're both sown at the same time of year. So they're really pushing themselves up, I suppose, whether it's in America, South America. So yeah, these things can move quickly. We're at the moment just a critical point for the US corn crop and it has been a bit dry there. So yeah, the next few weeks could see that shift around a lot. But certainly from barley's point of view, big knock-on effect onto the feed barley price. And again, that feeds into the malting as well. So I think, well, this is, we're looking at Scotland, potential crop areas this year. Not a massive change expected, a small increase in the spring barley area, up a little bit to 265. So that on the face of it looks relatively minor impact. But the UK as a whole, which is mainly England, it's had a huge swing back to wheat, given the better autumn. So that's something like there's something like a 2 million tonne or potentially up to 2 million tonne fall in spring barley production across England, which is quite huge. And of course, so that potentially pulls out some, well, both feed barley, but certainly potentially some malting barley from the UK market. And a lot of Western Europe is quite similar, that the autumn plannings were better and there's less spring barley around. So that seems quite positive to say that there are issues around demand, certainly just coming out of COVID, that sort of kept the malting market a little bit more subdued than it might otherwise be. So obviously, if we look at sort of whiskey exports, we've actually lost, 2020 was a poor year. We lost 23% off of our value of our exports, about £1 billion lost. And the tariffs, the US putting tariffs on Scotch malt whiskey was a major loss. And the Scottish Whiskey Association estimated that was maybe £600 million of lost sales. So that was a hard blow to the industry. And of course, COVID, whiskey, sort of premium drink often in the hospitality sector, hotels and around the world, that the whiskey sales have been hit by that. So that's where we've come from. However, there are some good things, some better things have appeared more recently. There was an agreement with the US and the UK that America suspended its tariffs on Scotch malt whiskey for 5 years, which we hope will become permanent. So that's excellent news. So really, we're very pleased about that in the industry. And of course, COVID we're slowly climbing back out of this whole issue of lockdowns and restrictions on, you know, sales and hospitality and things. Yeah, perhaps the UK is moving a bit faster than others with our vaccinations, but hopefully over the next sort of 6 months to a year, most of the rest of the world will start to approach to where we are, and we'll start to move out of the impact of that. And of course, there was another sort of trade deal recently announced between Australia and UK. And so there are 5% tariffs for Scotch whisky going to Australia. So they are going to be lifted over time. So these are all good, relatively positive things. And if we look at the actual use of malting barley in the UK, it was seriously down. It's still down 9% year on year because of COVID. But when you start to look at the monthly figures, it's starting to bump back up again. It's probably going to be a little bit volatile month to month. And April was particularly, was a major rise, 31% on obviously the COVID, when COVID really hit last year. But again, that's a positive sign. You know, we are still behind, but hopefully over the next few months, we'll start to see some normality there. And rebuild that sort of demand that we did lose. Now the next part, I suppose, is part. This is really the premium, and it's largely going to, I would think, okay, there may be global impacts of weather and demand, etc. But probably one of the biggest drivers is going to be how good a crop we have here, how big a crop, and what the quality is like. Premiums were obviously pretty hopeless at harvest. It was almost, whether you got a small premium or nothing at all. It was just depending on the time you sold it and what happened to feed barley price. So really, essentially, we had enough malting barley that was in that we needed in locally. And we were, the English market did have a premium, a reasonable premium. We didn't. So I think, yeah. What the balance of supply and demand in Scotland is ultimately going to decide if that is a premium or if it's relatively small. And a little bit hard to be sure at the moment. Demand's a little unclear as what it's going to be. I mean, it might recover quicker than we think. So we look at 2021, potentially still a little bit down on even this year, just until things recover, but maybe that'll recover quicker. 740,000 tons. The crop, the yields were tremendous last year. You'd assume on averages it might just drop back to more of a trend. So it was 6.8 last year, so maybe down to just around 6. But again, that's down to the weather. And then you've got a sort of assumption about varieties, malting varieties. But when you get moved to the 65%, that's essentially, you know, how much of the malting barley in the ground is going to have to make malting. To meet demand. So it's at the lower end of what we've seen. When you sort of squeeze the supply and you're needing sort of 85-90% of the barley to make malting, then you can start, the premiums have generally been stronger. So this is very early, obviously, to say. We just don't know how these crops are going to perform. And, you know, perhaps demand will pick up a bit quicker. There's obviously better, some good news out there. But just at the moment, the sort of the pressure might be on the premium again at harvest, unless, as I say, there are issues sort of globally, or there are some issues here in Scotland in terms of yields, etc. But yeah, it's just a difficult time of year to be sure what's going to happen there. The one thing we've obviously seen was that has squeezed our premiums is the fact that the varieties have come through, the varieties Steve was talking about, there's more in the pipeline. They are yielding better, they're delivering good productivity. That's helping keep the supply up in Scotland. On the individual farm, you know, those varieties do have advantages, of course, because at the end of the day, you're getting a bigger yield. Unfortunately, it'd be great to get a good yield and a good premium, and that's what we're all aiming for. But certainly, they're attractive to grow, relatively lower cost, some of them. And you've also got the fallback into feed and things like that. So, yeah. It's a bit of a mixed picture. It certainly has been putting the pressure on the premiums locally because of these better varieties, better conditions as well, perhaps. You know, and this will be, you know, whatever that yield is, comes at harvest, will have a huge impact on our own sort of premiums here in Scotland. And yeah, so this is just a little bit, just a wee 1 second last slide, just trying to sort of work out where we're heading. We don't know what the price at harvest is going to be, that and that just won't be clear till the crop comes in and we start to get the prices coming back out from the buyers. We, of course, there is barley on contract, different terms. If it's a premium over futures, of course, there's been some reasonably good opportunities with the base price being relatively strong for new crop wheat. So the sort of direction at the moment looks like prices should average out better than last season, which I think for most people would definitely be something they'd be looking for. But yeah, there's too many uncertainties at this stage. The brewing barley market, the forward price is about 185 from South Coast for X Farm going out on the South Coast. So that's sort of the European market at the moment for new crop. And of course, we tend to hover around. Do we get a premium to that? Do we sort of? Well, this year we're actually slightly under the English price. Yeah, again, that our differential will be depending on our own harvest. Now, there's just one final thing to raise, which is there's not an obvious answer to this, but it's obviously raising the emphasis on how farmers work and how, in terms of marketing, who they've got to sell to, what can farmers do to strengthen their hand in what is obviously can be a very competitive market. Yeah, we're unfortunately facing fewer buyers in Scotland this year for a number of reasons, and it's quite a shock, and it may jolt the sort of opportunity that the industry may want to take to try and find a better way forward. One grain merchant's taken over another one, so that was two buyers and now one. Another grain trader sadly went into liquidation, and that's obviously very concerning for the farmers involved, and they're a very difficult area to deal with for many, but obviously for the wider group of farmers, that's one less buyer. So we've lost two grain buyers in 1 year. You know, it does sort of really, this question's been in the industry for a long time. You know, how do farmers work together? How do they strengthen their position in terms of contract supply chain? You know, there are discussions underway from farmers. You know, now is an opportunity to sort of to get some momentum behind this to see if there's a better way to structure things and for the farmers to have a sort of stronger stake in how the crop's marketed. But yeah, no easy answers to this, but certainly it's a year where maybe this will come to the fore. So yeah, just to summarise, we were talking about barley, we're talking about malting barley, but at the moment, the thing that's potentially looks like the biggest factor could be actually the feed market around the world and what's happening in China, America. You know, and that has been really positive for that feed price. It's helped feed barley exports, helped the feed barley price. It's also bumping up that base that goes into the malting barley contracts. And that's all to play for at the moment, just a critical period. The UK, again, the wheat crop here it's going to be more. It's not necessarily a particularly bumper crop. And there's been low stocks. Plus, we've got some ethanol coming in, extra demand potential in the UK. So the UK is, again, looking pretty tight, pretty like this year. As a sort of base, we can move on to the malting barley. I think in our favour, we've got much less spring barley in England and parts of Europe. Yeah, we've got a bit more here in Scotland. Doesn't look a major increase, but again, it comes back to the, you know, what's a local yield? Are your local quality going to be? Because that is probably what the main thing that's going to push our premium up or down, and whether we get a bit more of a premium than we did last year, of course. The good news, the whisky sector is starting to recover. We can see a bit of daylight now. The tariffs have been lifted in the US. COVID restrictions are quite lifting, maybe slower than in some parts of the world, but that's relatively positive. And I think, as ever, you know, there are contracts there on some of the crop. Again, if budgets, you've got options there in terms of selling some forward. Obviously, anything that's not priced, we remain at to wait on harvest and see what that premium is going to be. And as I said, given the issues of the number of buyers out there, you know, this may well be a hot topic this year as the industry looks to try and find, you know, more sort of secure way of pricing the crops going forward and buying into the rest of the supply chain. But thanks very much. And that was the key things I wanted to cover today. Thank you.
Okay, thanks for that, Jillian. That was, I think, some some cautious optimism there, I think, for things going forward. So I think that's us come to the end of our speakers. So if anyone has any questions they would like to ask, now's your opportunity. I see we have a question here from Peter Davidson, which for Jillian while he's here, which I did kind of touch on with the demise of Alexander Inglis. Are farmers going to have to be more careful to who they sell to?
Well, no, I mean, yeah, it's always been an issue of farming, as you know. It can cause a huge amount of difficulties for farmers who get caught in this way, if that's the case for some people. It's just a difficult environment, and you know, everyone's got to just take some steps to try and manage that, sort of financial scores and things like that. And clearly everyone's happier if they've got a wider spread of buyers, but that's always not actually possible sometimes. So I think most people know the sort of theory of trying to reduce risk, but the practicalities in some parts of the country of finding a range of buyers for what you're producing is, you know, is unfortunately one of the problems. There aren't necessarily too many options. So yeah, there's tried and tested methods out there. It's just finding what you can actually apply in your own situation.
To yourself, yeah, that's great. I've got a wee question for Neil here. Have you got any comment on the availability of the elicitors that you mentioned for Scottish barley growers and the cost benefits of that?
Yeah, it's something that we've been looking at, and funnily enough, I'm just chasing up UPL just now. So Baxi plant has been the Lumminan product has been registered for wheat for a long time, but actually I saw Henry's question of just checking the UK website no longer shows it, although it's on their American website. So I'll chase up UPL and ask them what the situation is with that. My understanding was they were looking to get a barley registration to go along with the wheat, so why it's not on the website, we'll try and find out. And in terms of the cost benefit, we'll get these programs costed up and presented at the end of the season meeting.
And I think maybe a final time moving on, a final question to Steve. Has anyone noticed the RGT Planet straw strength issues in Scotland, as there has been some brackling issues in Ireland?
You're not aware of anything, but it's always interesting to pick up on any information that comes from other locations, you know, particularly where we've got a good idea of the climatic and the soil conditions. But the planet is quite resistant in that sense. So I wouldn't have expected too many problems. I'd be interested to know a bit more about what lies behind that.
Right, something to look at.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, there's another point about that. Yeah, okay, rattling problem, yeah, from John.
Yeah. So I think if that's with time moving on, I think we'll wrap things up there. I'd just like to thank all the speakers for contributing today. And of course, as this is a Farm Advisory Service webinar, we will be sending out an event survey. But as a bit of an encouragement, if you complete the survey, you will be entered into a prize draw. We've got a wee picture there just to prove there has been a previous winner. So we'd be really pleased if you could complete these forms and let us know how we've got on. And another date for your diary is next Tuesday. We've got an Arable Scotland webinar. If you go to the FAS website, there'll be more details on that and opportunity to book in for that webinar. And so just final thank you for all your attendance. And hopefully by this time next year, we'll be able to do some of these things on farm. So thank you again.
Okay. Thanks, Alistair. Bye, everybody.